Are you experiencing your shoulder getting stiffer and stiffer? And finally, when you go to reach things, that motion is limited and extremely painful? How's it going, everyone? This is Dr. Zach Greenwood here, Performance Sport and Spine. And today's video, I'll be discussing frozen shoulder, also known as adhesive capsulitis. And at this point, if you wouldn't mind liking the video, subscribing to our channel, and making sure the notifications are turned on. So frozen shoulder affects our shoulder joint, which is a ball and socket joint, comprised of the humeral head and the glenoid cavity of the scapula, as well as capsules, ligaments, muscles, and tendons. So what does this condition feel like? Is a condition which comes on slowly with pain over the shoulder and deltoid insertion, inability to sleep, painful incomplete elevation and external rotation, and is restricted in both active and passive range of motion. People also complain that there's a constant burning feeling. So there's no gold standard test for frozen shoulder, but what we can do is compare range of motion on the affected side to the unaffected side. And what they found is if you have a reduction of 25% in two planes or more on the affected side, and then a loss of 50% in external rotation on the affected side compared to the other side, and it's been the same or worse over 1 month, there's a good chance that the condition is frozen shoulder. There are other signs and symptoms that can help collaborate with this diagnosis that we'll discuss later in the video. So what's causing the pain and the stiffness that you're experiencing? Well, it turns out frozen shoulder is a complex condition, and there's a lot that we still don't know about it. But it's important to look at just the shoulder and also systemic factors. So when this condition starts, there's two subgroups. There's primary and secondary. Primary is idiopathic, which basically just means we don't know why it started. And then for secondary, it's a more specific reason, such as surgery, trauma, infections, diabetes, rotator cuff injuries. So with frozen shoulder, there's typically an early phase and a late phase. But it's important to know there's a lot of variability in presentations, so don't always think you'll have these classic two phases things. For the early phase, it's primary inflammation. Something has caused that shoulder to get very inflamed, which irritates the synovial or the capsule, and it increases these little cells called fibroblasts. And then as this condition progresses, we move into the late phase. And those fibroblasts we talked about earlier change into myofibroblasts. And this causes an increase in collagen and contracture of that capsule. So your shoulder capsule actually shrinks quite a lot, and that's what's causing that loss of range of motion when you try to move your arm up. It's been shown in normal shoulders that the volume is between 15 and 35 cubic centimeters, compared to frozen shoulder, where severe cases have been shown to have only 5 to 6 cubic centimeters. Now we've got to go over three big myths about frozen shoulder, because there's a lot of misinformation about this that really impairs people and limits their progress and full recovery. So the first one is that frozen shoulder should be the term to use, not adhesive capsulitis. Remember, that capsule is shrunk. There's not small adhesions causing the lack of range of motion. And then secondly, we need to make sure people are reassured that severe pain at end range is normal with this condition. And the last thing you want to do is not use your shoulder. So the goal is to move the shoulder to tolerable pain and then try to increase that range of motion over time. And then lastly, you may have heard of like freezing, frozen, and thawing with frozen shoulder, but it turns out this isn't actually happening. This paper found that most people increased range of motion early in the condition and had a much harder time later on. And if you think back to what we talked about, early in, it's inflammation, and that contracture hasn't happened with the collagen. Again, if you wait long enough and that contracture starts to shrink, it's much harder to increase range of motion because the tissue is physically impairing you rather than the pain is just stopping you. And then unfortunately, there appears to be no evidence that this condition just gradually gets better on its own. So early evidence-based interventions is key for a good prognosis. So with this condition, progress is probably going to be slower than you like. So one little hack that you can do to provide immediate feedback is use a goniometer. And what you do on the first visit or for yourself is establish a baseline. Measure how much range of motion you have in a plane or two. And then the next week or 2 weeks, remeasure it. And you may find that you feel like you've made no progress, but if you measure objectively, you might say, hey, actually, I've increased 10 degrees in the last 2 weeks. So it helps motivate you. So now we're gonna go over some great stretches, exercises, and mobilizations. But first, we gotta talk about tolerable pain. And that's gonna be personalized to each individual. For some general criteria, we say for acute conditions, the pain should not exceed 2 out of 10, where 0 is no pain and 10 is the worst pain you can possibly imagine, and should calm down within a few hours. For non-acute conditions, maybe up to a 4 out of 5, and as long as it calms down by the next day, that will be fine. But again, this will be different for each person, so it's really important that you kind of set these parameters before you start, because if you crank on the shoulder too much, your pain's gonna be way worse and it's not gonna be helpful at all. So the first stretch is shoulder flexion. So laying on your back, clasp your hands together, keep your elbows in. And then you're slow and controlled, drive your hands up over your head to that tolerable pain that you decided earlier. And then you try to hold for 20 to 30 seconds. And again, should be tolerable, don't crank on this. If you're grimacing, if you're sweating, if your eyes are closed, you're pushing too hard, and then you're gonna relax. You repeat that 2 to 3 times a day, and then try to increase 10 seconds per time. And then as your range of motion improves and your hands can get close to over your head, what we can do is we can pull our elbows in towards each other, which helps focus the stretch on the anterior capsule of the shoulder. And then we can also drive your elbows outwards, which focuses more stress on the posterior shoulder. Same dosage and progression apply as the previous exercise. Another option that you can try is just using a dowel and pressing your shoulder out into lateral abduction as far as you can and hold for about 20, 30 seconds. And again, trying to increase over time. You can also do external rotation or flexion. So it may be smart to experiment with different techniques and see what seems to help increase your range of motion the best. The next stretch is to reach behind your back. So with the affected shoulder up, you're going to cradle your head with your down arm and try to take your hand and reach back as far as you can. Now it may be pretty limited, so again, don't crank too hard and then hold the tolerance for 20, 30 seconds, increasing over time. You may find that trying to retract or pull your shoulder blade towards your spine can help. So before you initiate your hand movement, pull your shoulder blade in towards your spine as far as you can, and then move your hand. And again, hold to that tolerable pain. Don't crank on it. Another stretch you can do is in the sideline position. Keep your elbow straight, raise your arm up as high as you can. And then again, hold for that 20, 30 seconds, trying to increase over time. And what's great about this one is after you get above 90, the weight of your arm starts to pull you into that stretch. And so you can kind of use the weight of your arm to help stretch more intensely. But again, always to tolerable pain. So another thing with this condition is a shoulder shrug sign. So as that ball and socket gets tight, people will elevate their shoulder as a compensatory movement. So if you look at me on the right here, I'm raising my arm in a normal fashion. On the left here, I'm shrugging my shoulder to compensate for the lack of range of motion in my shoulder. And then we can add some weight bearing exercises. So getting a bench, you may need to adjust the height higher or lower depending on your current fitness level and pain, but we can start with just some gentle circles clockwise and then counterclockwise. We also can add kind of shoulder flexion or getting up on our toes. You can go diagonal up, diagonal back, side to side. Again, this is a multiplanar joint, so you want to kind of mobilize it in every direction. As you get more range of motion and your pain decreases, you either can get on the floor or you can just try to go farther in those motions. A further progression is to use a foam pan, so placing your hands on the pad, which provides an instability. You can again do the circles and the different diagonals and lateral back and forth to increase the shoulder range of motion. Another great exercise is just the ball roll. So placing a light ball on the wall, press your hand up to tolerance, and again, start out going straight ahead, and then you wanna go in different diagonals. Again, challenging that joint and all the different planes that it'll be used, even going out straight to the side. I found some people respond better to just using their fingers to kind of actively pull their hand up the wall as far as possible, and either walking back down or just resetting, and then again, walking out into different planes. And then towards the more middle part of the rehab, you can start doing the hand walk out to start getting some more load in that flexion position, and then again, holding and stretching at that kind of end range, that tolerable pain, and then walking back, and then again, walking out and holding to the left and to the right, with the goal of trying to increase how far your hands are away from your knees over time. And then once you've kind of really progressed through this and you have full range of motion, it's important to reintroduce speed. A lot of times with this condition, you've had it for so long that when you raise your arm, it's very slow and guarded and not really what you're gonna do in life, right? You're not gonna raise it super slow. So you wanna be able to do it fast. So what a great tool is to use a light weight and then practice rapidly raising your hand in different planes. And if the weight's too heavy, you can get like a water bottle, but it's important to rebuild and reintroduce speed slowly over time. So that way when you go to grab something, it's not like it's just used to going slow, but that speed has been adapted to. So like we talked about earlier, this is more than just a shoulder issue. There's systemic factors to this. So research has shown that cardiovascular conditioning exercises can help. And they can do so by improving your mood, increasing your metabolic rate, reducing adipose tissue and pro-inflammatory markers, reducing systemic inflammation, and reducing pain. So some general facts about this condition. It's most commonly found in people between 40 and 65 years of age. It typically lasts between 1 and 3 years, with 30 months being the average. It's about 1 to 5% of the population. It's more common in females than males. It's often in the non-dominant arm. And it's much more prevalent in the obese and diabetic population. Prior episodes can increase your chance of frozen shoulder, as well as prolonged immobilization. Family history is relevant. And there appears to be an increase that the opposite arm will get frozen shoulder within 6 months of your prior onset. And then some things that can decrease your prognosis are depression, anxiety, again, systemic factors, diabetes, and then prolonged symptoms. Again, the longer you have it, the more that capsule contracts, and the more that collagen contracts, the harder it is to restore range of motion. So it appears that there's a large element of muscle guarding, at least in the early phase of this condition. So if you look at this paper right here, they took 5 participants and they measured the range of motion in a sideline position. And then those same patients were put on anesthesia and the range of motion was measured again. And what they found was after the patients were on anesthesia, the range of motion increased from 53 to 105 degrees in abduction. And 3 of the patients' external rotation range of motion increased from 15 to 41 degrees. So this reveals that there's a lot of muscle guarding with this condition, which is another reason why you shouldn't just crank on it or stretch excessively. Corticosteroid injections. There is strong evidence to support their use in the early or inflammatory stage. There's short-term pain reduction and improved function, and their effects seem to be enhanced when they're guided. However, once you get to late stage and the capsule has shrunk, injections appear to have less effect as the capsule being shrunken is a primary problem, not inflammation. There are some other conditions that we should be aware of that can present somewhat similarly. So a locked dislocation, but this would probably have recent trauma, there might be palpable defects, and a positive x-ray. Fractures, again, recent trauma and positive radiographic films. Avascular necrosis, which is a deadening of the bone, and this can be caused by trauma, steroid use, or chemotherapy. Arthritis, and this is more limited in all range of motions, not just external rotation, and most likely the patient is older, in their 60s or 70s. Osteosarcoma, which is a cancer of the humeral head, more found in kids between 10 and 20 years old. And then rotator cuff tendinopathy. Here, the patients would have much more passive range of motion than active range of motion, and there's probably pain and weakness with resisted shoulder motions. Thank you so much for watching our video on frozen shoulder. We hope this provides some clarity and then some great stretches and exercises to help improve your condition. If you did find this video helpful, please like it and subscribe to our channel, and don't forget to check out our other videos.